the goal or the essence of the CBAM is to prevent situations where companies based in Europe are going to shift their productions of carbon-intensive goods outside of the EU, where there is less stringent climate policies. The CBAM is not going to be applicable to all goods for now. It's going to be restricted to a couple of these goods to start with, mainly the cement, the iron and steel, aluminium, fertilizers, electricity, and hydrogen. If you are a declarant or if you are an importer and you have a direct relationship with a supplier, you will be subject to the CBAM, and you will have to supply reports for now till 2026. And then by early 2026, you will have to buy CBAM certificates actually to have the capability to import these goods outside of the EU. Primary data is the data that you collect in the field and that you are using to calculate in an accurate way a carbon footprint, versus secondary data, which is based, generally speaking, on emission factors that you can collect from emission factor databases. So if we make the analogies with the CBAM, primary data is going to be actual data, default values will be secondary data. After 3 or 4 quarters, there will be allowance of only 20% of default values, and companies must calculate the emissions using actual data, or what we call primary data again. I think this is one of the most significant challenges we have nowadays when it comes to collecting and evaluating carbon footprints and emissions generated by a typical organization. This is something that we experience at Optel on a daily basis when we work with our customers to help them to reach out to their suppliers, because some of these suppliers may not have the information available for many reasons. One of them is because they never do that, done that. The second thing is because they don't want actually to supply sensitive information related to their production processes and so on. So it's very important to engage with your suppliers as soon as possible and to explain the reason why you are collecting this this data, and what will be the risk on the business relationship between both, because if the supplier is not going to provide this information or this data, there will be a risk for non-compliance, and this will increase the cost, there will be penalties. So it's very important to engage with the supplier as soon as possible to explain these kind of constraints. And obviously at the same time, there might be a risk that this supplier will not comply at all. So maybe it's good to reach out to the supply chain team and the procurement team and make sure that they engage with other suppliers who will be willing to comply with the CBAM requirements. The first report has to be submitted by January 2024, and then there will be obviously less requirements in terms of quality of data, as we mentioned earlier, when it comes to actual versus default values. And then within 3 quarters from then, you will have more constraints in terms of the quality of the reports and the amount of secondary or default data versus the actual data. There is a cost, obviously, of compliance itself, because you need to start as soon as possible to collect data and generate reports. So you need to develop this expertise inside your organization. You need to select the right tool that will allow you to automate and to facilitate the data collection and the interaction with your different suppliers. And there will be some challenges related to that, because data has to be automatically collected, it has to be securely exchanged between the different stakeholders, and obviously this is a team effort, It has an, I think the CBAM is going to have impact on the organization in many departments, starting from the R&D and product design, from product management, who is going to have maybe an impact on the cost of good of the of its product, from operations and sourcing, because they will probably need to deal with different suppliers who are going to provide this data, but sometimes they will need to maybe source from other suppliers who are going to be in a more collaborative approach when it comes to providing the data. But also you can make a decision to select a supplier who is going to have a lower carbon footprint of the product that he's supplying, and this will have impact on either the CBAM certificate itself or on the cost of good of the product that you are making in the EU. It's good. It's a good start. I mean, many organizations are using Excel spreadsheets at the beginning to get started with calculating one or two product carbon footprints and having the a first assessment about what's going on in a particular product and what's going on in their supply chain. But this is not a scalable approach because, as I mentioned earlier, as it engages many stakeholders inside the organization and also outside the organization, I think a software solution would make a lot of sense because it will help, first of all, to automate the data collection, second, to give access to many stakeholders to monitor all the efforts to calculate emissions and to reduce them, and third, also it will be a very good tool to automate and to exchange actually the data in a secure manner between the supplier and the end customer, especially now with the efforts of the pact. There is a framework that is now in place and that is defined by the WBCSD to facilitate the data collection and the data exchange between the supply chain actors. And absolutely, security is an issue, and that's why I think PACT is in place, because it will help to exchange the data between different actors in considering two main concerns. The first one is the security of the data exchange using secure connections, and second also is the anonymous aspect of the data, because you can go through a supply chain with multiple tiers, and it's very important to prevent that different actors are not going to see data from other actors in the supply chain, especially when it comes to competitions. And this is where the traceability solution provided by Opdale combined with the PACT initiative is going to be a very good fit for many of our customers. Well, there will be the transitional CBAM registry is an electronic system that is developed by the CBAM. They are organizing various webinars over the next few weeks to help get familiar with the technology. And through the transitional CBAM registry, there will be a step-by-step approach to submit the different reports. Well, cements, iron, steel, aluminium, fertilizers, electricity, and hydrogen are concerned now by the CBAM, but we are expecting more and more products that are going to be under these regulations. It's never too late and it's never too early, so you have to start now to understand what's going on in your supply chain, what's going on in your products. And so you are going to be ready whenever the time comes to be compliant with the CBAM.